I read a very sweet story of a devotee of Bhagwan, Ramana Maharshi. So he was practicing self-inquiry, but felt he wasn't making progress, trying very hard. And he told himself, "What is the point of going and sitting with Bhagwan? If I'm not able to make progress, I will stop visiting him." And he stayed away for 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. And one day he woke up crying. And he didn't know what to do. So he ran to Bhagwan and fell at his feet, and Bhagwan asked him, "What happened?" He said, "You know, I've tried it so hard. I feel I'm not making any progress. I'm not making any improvement. But I could not bear it anymore. So I've come and fallen at your feet." So Bhagwan said, "That is all very well. Forget all that you couldn't understand it, you couldn't practice self-inquiry. But did you feel the loss? Did you feel the loss?" Very deep message here. Because many of us don't get teachings beyond a point. We feel frustrated that we can't imbibe them, can't follow them. That is the limit of the mind. But obviously, this devotee had felt Bhagwan here, so he could not bear the absence. So it had hit the heart. And this is a very important pointer, because many people say they understand everything, they accept it, but to put it into practice is difficult. So, if it has hit the heart, and this was a clear example that it had, it is an irreversible process. But we must ask ourselves, whichever teaching we are following, whichever teacher we are following, how do we feel in its absence? You see, there is a bridge which needs to be crossed. And many people are not able to cross that bridge. Many people get stuck on the bridge. That is the limitation of the intellectual understanding. I remember when I was 14 or 15 years old, I had lost my father young. So whenever there was news of somebody's death, it could be a family member, a stranger, anyone, it would shake me up. Death was a great learning for me in my younger days. I was consumed by this phenomenon. And there was fear, because there was fear of survival. My mother was not qualified to earn money. She had 3 children to feed and so on. And I remember during my exams, and a lot of our exams was about mugging up history, geography and all mental activity. And whenever fear arose, I would tell myself that, look, if something is meant to happen, no matter how much I worry about it and I'm afraid of it, it will happen. My worry is not going to prevent it from happening. My fear of it happening will not prevent it from happening. This is what I would tell myself. And if it is not meant to happen, imagine all the time I wasted about worrying. I used to tell this to myself. It became like a mantra. So whenever any fear arose, this dialogue would start in the mind. If it is meant to happen, this fear is not going to stop it from happening. The worry is not going to stop it from happening. And if it is not meant to happen, so much time would have been wasted in worrying. But that stayed as a mental dialogue. That did not give me peace. That became again another dialogue of the mind. A rational, logical construct of life. I was fortunate I went through this at a very young age. That bridge was not crossed. That crossing of the bridge, later on I understood, happens without your doing and without your knowing. You soon find yourself on the other side. And that happens because of 2 factors. Surrender and grace. If one is not totally surrendered, that bridge is not crossed. Not surrender just to a person, surrender to a teaching, surrender to what life brings unasked. Many times pain, sometimes pleasure. There's another incident where another devotee complains to Bhagwan all the time that I'm with you for so much, but I don't feel that your grace is upon me. Constant complaint, always in Bhagwan's company, but somehow feel something lacking. And Bhagwan tells him, he says, you are like the man who is immersed in the Ganges till his neck and then tells someone to go and get a glass of water from a neighbor nearby, for he wants to drink it. That is the limit of the mind, the limit of the intellect. It's a beautiful book I'm reading on the 75 devotees of Ramana Maharshi, written by Ganesan ji. I would highly recommend it to everyone. Maybe two or three pages per devotee, rich with these stories. Beautiful, beautiful stories. And you know what true devotion is when you read this book. When I read it, I feel my devotion to my teacher was half-baked, quarter-baked perhaps. When I see what all these beings did for their master, it's just phenomenal. Now we are only devoted to our mobile phones. That is true devotion for us. It's very beautiful. I received an email, which perhaps I'll address in one Zoom talk, but it came up now because of a similar subject. So there is someone who says that he has faced a lot of traumas in life, financial, physical, emotional, etc. And he accepts the teachings and understands them fully, about abiding in the being and the I am teachings, etc. But he feels that the body still holds on to the trauma and the anxiety. So the question was, amongst three or four questions, can the body rest in being? Because my understanding is clear, but the body does not support the understanding. So the body can rest, but the body cannot rest in being. Beingness, consciousness, is a sense of being. The body is inert. A dead body is the body without consciousness. But because the ego has taken the body to be me, it becomes a center of attraction, so that when anything happens in the mind, mental, emotional, it gets absorbed as an energy form in the body. Now, the absence of the thinking mind that doesn't go into the dead past or into the imaginary future, that means one is resting in being, not in had been and not in becoming. But this point is missed. Resting in being is as simple as that. Acceptance of what is. So let us say prior to the teaching and after being exposed to the teaching. Let's say prior to the teaching, you hated people for what they did to you. And so you would get all worked up and you would blame and you'd get anxious and you'd get frustrated and angry and so on. And then the teaching comes along and says, look here, just look at this in a different light. Nobody truly does anything. We all are coming with our blueprint. We all are coming with our conditioning, our genetics, and events happen and deeds are done. No one is the doer of their deeds. Now, with this new understanding, you have a situation in life. You meet someone who upsets you or threatens you or says something you don't like. The knee-jerk reaction may still be there based on past condition, but that gets cut off immediately with the teaching. So there is no involvement in that knee-jerk reaction. For someone whom the teaching has had a very deep impact on, even that may not arise, the knee-jerk reaction, because the understanding comes almost simultaneously that this person is an equal expression of the divine just as I am. So the agitation either drops off faster than it used to before the teaching, or it doesn't arise in some cases, depending on each one's destiny. But if the agitation still arises, if there is still involvement in the agitation, if you still dislike people and you say, yes, I understand everything what the teaching is saying, I accept it, but all this still arises, then that means while the teaching has been understood, it has not been imbibed. It is a clear sign that it has not been imbibed. Different people progress in different ways. Progress, what I mean is on the journey to peace. Some who have had a lot of exposure to abuse and nastiness when they are young may take more time. Others, it may be faster. But if one feels that the anxiety, the stress, the tension is not reduced compared to before the teaching, then the teaching's impact has only been at the mental level. Even that can't be discounted, because some people may reject the teaching totally. So that is not, does not mean it is lesser in any way, but it's a pointer that if you do feel that there's no difference in your level of anxiety and stress, then it is still only understood logically and at a mental level. It is not lived. And if you do feel that now whatever happens in life is viewed through this prism, and you have a deep conviction that you can't go back to your old self and look at life the way you used to, then the turning has happened. If deep down you ask yourself, I can no longer now look at people, strangers, family, friends, I can no longer look at them with my old eyes. It's impossible because now the teaching is in my blood. Then the turning has happened. The turning away from separation. To face the source. And that starts the end of the Rinanubandhan, the bondage to relationships, be it people, be it events that transpire in your life, or situations that take place. If you accept a situation as God's will, you may not like it, but you accept that this came to me unasked. Certainly not my will. Already in that acceptance, the bondage is broken because you are no longer bound into an action-reaction pattern based on ignorance, which one was bound to earlier. You are no longer bound by your earlier tendencies to judge situations, judge people, and so on and so forth. You accept it as the will of the Divine. चलो
My grandparents both sides died almost before I was born, so I never lived with elderly people. And I never really lived amongst really old people or above 50 or 60. And now we are living with his living with his father. We made him come with us to Bombay. His father. He's 80 and alcoholic. And it's the first time I'm living with him. So, since some months or since we met you, I have this feeling of what a punishment life is. What a waste. And when I see his father, I feel that more and more. What a waste to have life. So when I was coming here in Ecuador, I never get this question, but in Mumbai, whenever I am coming in a taxi and I see the people and the buildings and all, maybe that makes me feel it so. But today when I was coming, a burst of crying happened. And I was angry at God that why did he make the illusion so thick? It's so hard to break through. I don't know if that's a question or it's a feeling.
I think for anyone who is drawn to the spiritual journey and spiritual path, it is actually a blessing, because many people live their lives in unawareness on the wheel of karma. And so when awareness dawns, it doesn't mean things become easier. Things start getting seen for what they are. This question, if it comes up for you, it does not mean it comes up for everyone else also. And one realizes that even the one who feels life is a punishment and the illusion is thick, even that is part of the illusion. And that is why Ramana Maharshi has said that the purpose of life is to wake up and realize. I mentioned it recently, I think, in one talk, where he said, if not at the first blow, then definitely by the fourth or fifth blow, you wake up and ask these questions. What is life about? Why do these things happen? Because you are facing life full on now with these questions. Life is not about just being in Ecuador. In fact, one should be thankful that all this happens, you see. Life is painful for many people. For many, much worse than the pain you have experienced also. Then, as they say, one will be thankful for one's pain. I know two people. One complained that his salary in the lockdown is -50%. And he is finding it hard to make ends meet. And I met someone else who said they've lost their job. Now, if you told the person who's lost 50% that, can you imagine if you lost all? He would be very happy he's getting 50%. See how relative pain is also. The relativity of it. It's amazing. There was one very rich couple, is rather. Now, the man is in his 80s, the wife passed away. And the wife passed away of a physical ailment, which affected the muscles and the full body. And it was very tedious and slow process. So, because it was visible, all their friends, the attention was on the wife. And after she passed on, I found out from this man's friend, who's also in his 80s, that he had heart attacks, cancer, blood pressure, but quietly his life went on. Now, who had more pain? In this case, body ailment, not mental or... What is... It is so relative. So, what part of the pain is most painful for you? Everything? Or certain things? Which, what would you describe as being most painful?
I don't think my life has many setbacks or something like that. It's not about the physical or mental pains. I don't have any, any issues which I had in the past or nothing of that sort. But just the the idea of, like, I think, like, my husband, and now I relate to him, and then I die, and it get born again and I have new parents, a new husband, then he becomes my loved one. My loved ones are different. I forget about all the old, past life loved ones. What was the point of it? Just the pain of having life. I mean, life is not as it, but like people complain that this is happening, that is happening. Nothing of that sort. Much big things have happened in my life. It's not smooth, it's not rough, it's normal. But it's not about the story of the life. No, it's about the life itself.
People would think you're in a very luxurious situation, you know. Deep down it is true, because if we asked someone that, supposing you had an option of deep sleep forever and ever and ever, from which you don't come out, or you have the option of keeping on coming out of deep sleep, facing life's challenges, pleasures, pains, and going back to deep sleep, waking up, pleasures, pains, going back to deep sleep, at a point you will feel that you're tired of even this. You'd rather be in deep sleep all the time, which is what realization is, that the pleasures and pains of life are seen as being transient on the screen of consciousness. For the jnani, what you have said is actually true. Maharaj himself has said that I am tired even to just wake up and go to sleep is too much activity. You see, if one is resting in the self, yes. But that is what this whole journey is about. That is the pain of separation. That is the, what is the word? It is the intrinsic pain of separation that everyone is born with. Separation from the source. Look at a jnani like Vivekananda. Extreme poverty. Painful. His own guru would tell the Divine Mother, what are you doing to my number one devotee? Pain. Now look at an alcoholic. An alcoholic does not choose to be alcoholic. People find that very hard to accept. You are responsible to be an alcoholic. You can't control your alcohol intake. So many times I've seen it. In Bombay, there are stories of people with alcoholism. And then they feel they are doing the alcoholic a favor by taking care of the alcoholic. It's possibly the other way around. The alcoholic is doing you a favor. Who knows?
So this thing runs in my family. My dad is an alcoholic. And this thing runs in my family where my dad is alcoholic. And growing up, we faced all the troubles of my dad being alcoholic, where he would create, you know, once he struggled, he would create drama. And then my mom would get instigated. And we as kids did not know what to do. And now we have grown up. And now I'm blessed to have the understanding that he did not choose. I see that he is suffering, and I just have compassion for him. But on the other hand, my brother, my sister-in-law, and his kids, they're all in this blame game where they think that he's doing it purposely, and he just wants to trouble us. But I see the whole picture where everybody is perfect. My dad can't, he didn't choose to be alcoholic. He's actually a victim of alcohol. And I also see my brother and sister-in-law, but they don't have this understanding. And so they are also right in their place where, and so I'm lucky to be coming out of that circle where I'm not playing that game anymore.
That is the beauty of it. That is the beauty of satsang, being in the company of truth. You are out of that game. You have gotten off the Ferris wheel of life.
But there is this feeling where I feel like, how can I help? I can't help my dad because, you know, he is now at a level where he can't understand anything that I would say. And his body, his physicality is so, in a way, you know, attuned to alcohol that he can't live. It's like his medicine.
Right.
He has to take it. But my brother and sister-in-law, they are still there. And I know if I try to tell them, sometimes I try. But the thing is that we have to bear all the trouble. It's easy for me to...
to give gyan.
Yeah, tell and you know, but we have to face it.
Sure, sure.
And I have to see their point. And so this time when I came back, I brought him here because they get some peace.
Yes, that's sensitive of you to do that.
And I was also trying to make a point that, you know, I'm not just talking. I can live with him. When he's sober, we have a very loving relationship.
Right.
He respects me a lot. I love him a lot. Once the medicine is in, he goes nuts. But now when he's with me, he doesn't even feel like drinking. And so, so I was trying to basically give them a chance to see that, you know, one can live with an alcoholic, there doesn't need to be so much trouble. So that's the only way I can tell them that there is, you know, instead of giving a sermon or a lecture.
Sure. Living by example, but also there must be protocols and you know, like there's rehab, for example, so you could consult professionals on how to deal with the situation. They may have the experience. I don't know if you've done that, but that could be looked at.
Yeah, my dad is out of, like, beyond
normal.
My sister-in-law and brother-in-law need some kind of consultation because they don't understand that he's actually a sick person.
That's the problem, that awareness is not there, you see, but now that is their destiny. And what do you feel about having him in Bombay?
It has been only 2 or 3 days.
But do you feel that it is a burden?
No, he hasn't had alcohol since, because we live in a dry zone, so it's not possible for him to have alcohol. So I don't know when that situation will arise, how I will deal with it.
Right.
But as of now, no, it's not a burden.
But when you started by saying, when you look at someone like him and you feel the illusion is so strong, like you were saying, generally even driving from your place here.
Yes.
What were you referring to?
It's just like, you know, I find it hard to explain. Like his, when I go to his village, people ask us every time, why don't you have babies? I just say I'm not interested, but inside I feel like I don't want to waste my life. What's the point in having babies?
Right.
So, I mean, it's not about just being born and then you get old and then die. and then you forget that story, and then you get born again. It's so, I mean, it's not bad. So, and also this identification with the body, like, I still feel I'm the body.
But you are the body. You see, that is what even Rameshji would keep pointing out, that people make this mistake. They have to function as a body-mind mechanism with an ego. That is the functional aspect of life. Because if you start saying you're not the body and you act like a zombie, it's that's not what the teachings are saying.
No, I mean, I don't have the realization yet that I am the consciousness. The resting in being happens sometimes on its own, but I mean, just the identification that I am this body only is strong, and I see that around with everybody around and
everybody.
Everybody.
There is this misconception, you know, that we have to live as the all-pervasive consciousness and oneness, etc., etc., etc. And there's no question of realizing the consciousness, because you are, where, how can you realize what you are in that sense? If you were not conscious, you could not ask this question. So nothing has to be attained in terms of realizing the consciousness.
So once we realize and understand this, is it like we have forget everything, just live like that?
It depends. The measure, as I always say, is your peace of mind. That is the only thing, and you will know whether you are at peace or not at peace. If something happens, let's say I had an incident at work 2 days ago, I had two incidents at work, which could be classified as painful in terms of operations and financially in these lockdown times, right? Now, I am living my life as an individual confronted with a situation. A situation arises. It may cause me pain. But when it is accepted totally, the story is finished. What happens? One now focuses on how to deal with the situation to the best of one's ability. So no action is taken detrimental to myself, because I am flowing through life, a situation arises, no drama and story has accumulated around it, because there's a full acceptance of the situation. Then am I not living as, let's say, beingness or consciousness? Is not it as simple as that? There's no blame, there's no condemnation. My mind is free of thinking. That's as simple as abiding in being. It doesn't mean I'm free of the body. It doesn't mean anything fancy. It doesn't mean I'm going into a samadhi state. I'm living the life simple. Till the last breath, that has to happen. I am not, I as in not me, I am not reincarnating into the story of life by going round and round this wheel of this happened to me and that person did this to me and so on and so forth, then what is being reborn and what dies? Where is the continuity? It is snapped. The stories are dissolving as soon as they start. That's what happens. The small chapters of your life, the incidents, the episodes, the story of your life is over before it has begun. Because you realize that words are only half the story. They are written on empty paper. That paper is the silence of life. The silence which is here right now. Behind the words, between the words, around the words. The silence does not reincarnate. It does not go anywhere. It is the me that reincarnates. Forget other lives. We are talking of this life. If something happens to me in my childhood, I get stuck to it. And that is my identity now. And I keep reincarnating into that identity. If I was made a victim, my whole story is I am a victim, I am a victim, I am a victim, I am a victim. This one victimized me, that one is victimizing me. It's going on and on. If I accept that the victim and the perpetrator were both played by the hand of God, I'm a blank slate. I'm open to what may happen tomorrow. Because I have not held on to that story, that self-image, me and my story of life, my past conditioning, how I view life. And I come back to this point where we began. That is the grace. It is the grace, it is the light which comes in into one's life. That is the light which makes one cross the bridge.